Welcome everybody. Chef Katie May here for another episode of Delicious Living, where it's about creating more flavor, vitality, and joy for you to live a delicious life. So today we're making cauliflower pizza bites. I was gonna say cheesy cauliflower, but cauliflower pizza bites with the quickest but delicious pizza sauce, a dipping sauce for these pizza bites. So I hope you guys are excited for this one. The recipe you can get in the description below this video. There's a link to it on the blog, but I suggest opting in for our email list where you'll get the PDF sent to you so you can easily print it, and it will include the quick and easy pizza sauce that is not on the blog. Okay, so I'm going to tell you more about that in a minute, but definitely if you want the PDF recipe to print out, just opt in for the featured recipe via the link in the descriptions. Okay, so to get started, yes, let me know if there's any issues sound-wise, but it sounds like we're good to go. So I've got some quinoa here we're gonna blend up in a minute, some fresh parsley, a big cauliflower we're about to use, all of my herbs and spices, and let's get to it. So we have first up our cauliflower. Here we're going to chop up this head. But we're gonna put this into the food processor, so it doesn't need to be chopped fine. I'm just going to break up the head into these bigger pieces, and I can chop it a little bit or break it up a little bit more as I'm putting it into the food processor. But basically, we just need it so that it's small enough to catch the blade of the food processor that we have here. So I'm gonna show you. This is my big Cuisinart 16 or 12 cup actually Cuisinart food processor. I recommend getting a big one, where whether it's 12, 14, or even 16 cup. The 16 cup Cuisinart food processor is on my wish list because it's got a couple extra features, the dicing blade, and it can even peel, which is incredible. But anyways, we want a bigger food processor so you can do this all in one batch. If you're either working with a small processor or you have a huge head of cauliflower, then you might want to do this in two batches, okay? We only need a small head of cauliflower, so I'm actually not even going to add all of this in. I'm going to leave out just a little bit of it. Let's take that one out. And again, we want these pieces just small enough so that the blade will catch the cauliflower, okay? And you can throw in, if you got a big chunk of stem there, no worries, just throw that in there as well. It will soften up in the oven, of course, and we're blending it into these fine pieces. So we're getting that in there first so that we can process this a little more, because like I said, it's pretty full. We want to, my food processor is not even clicked in here. So first things first, you always want to make sure that your processor is fully in place before filling it. And each processor is a little bit different, but once you know yours, it should be pretty easy. And we pulse this a few times. We have a cashew allergy here. You can use another nut, of course, or you could use a seed. Hemp seed is my favorite replacement for the cashews. I just see a bigger piece of cauliflower in here, so I'm going to break it up once more a little bit, and then we're going to process this again with all of our other ingredients, so no need to process that to break up that little bit I just showed you. So instead of cashews, you can do another nut. Walnut, pecans, almonds, really any nut would work, or hemp seeds or sunflower. So I wouldn't do pumpkin seeds. Pumpkin seeds, the flavor's too strong in a direction that you wouldn't want to take the pizza bites, but basically any other seed or nut could work, okay? So the cashews I'm adding here, along with, and you can just leave these cashews out, absolutely, you can leave them out. You just have to think about the texture, the consistency of your dish, of the batter that you're making. So if you're leaving out the cashews, which add substance, some dryness, right? They help to absorb the moisture and make it a little bit more dry. Then you might want to add more of something else like the flaxseed or nutritional yeast, or just decrease the volume of your cauliflower, or leave out the bell pepper. That would be another way to reduce the sweetness, okay? Or reduce the moisture content. So I just added my nutritional yeast. I'm adding in my flaxseed. But before I do that, what I want to do with the flaxseed is actually add 2 tablespoons of lemon juice here, and then 2 tablespoons of water. And this isn't essential. You could add them right to the food processor. But this will help gelatinize the flax seeds a little bit by adding the water and the lemon juice first. Okay, so 2 tablespoons of the water. And then we're just going to mix this up a little bit. Okay. While that sits, I'm going to dice up my onion. We only need about 4 ounces of onion, so I've got a kind of a medium large onion here, so I don't need all of it. Say about half will be good. And again, these, just like the cauliflower, it doesn't need to be diced really finely because it's going into the food processor, okay? Just scrape all that to the side. And just make some wider cuts here. And we'll add it all to the processor. So we've got lots of flavor here. This is an easy dish where you can actually change up the vegetables. I would not do that on your first couple times of making this, because you want to get an idea of the batter consistency you're looking for, okay? So don't switch up any of the vegetables now, but down the road, once you've practiced this recipe, you can actually switch out the veggies for something else, you know, mushroom instead of onion, or different peppers. You could do some hot peppers in here if you wanted to. Really lots of options. Okay, and I'm getting all my pepper. And again, you don't need to add this the full amount. The recipe calls for, let me see here. We've got four ounces of bell pepper, so one medium. I'm gonna say I have a little bit larger one because, again, the moisture content. If it's too moist, then you're going to end up with a batter that might fall apart a little bit more. So I'd rather err on the side of having it be a little drier than too moist. Okay, and if you want to measure all this out, then you can do that. I actually say exactly 4 ounces of bell pepper. You can just add this here. We have a dipping sauce to go with this, so that's going to add, you know, if it was a little bit too dry, you have some moisture with the dipping sauce, okay? Now, all of our spices. We've got garlic granules, oregano. That's 1.5 tablespoons of oregano, 1 tablespoon of thyme, the garlic granules, and some red pepper flakes. Again, all of the exact measurements and the instructions are in the recipe, which you can get if you opt in via the link in the description, and then I'll send you the PDF right away. So I've got my flax and lemon and a little bit of water in here. I'm adding that mixture. And now we're just gonna process this. Lid on and pulse it. I like to pulse so that you get the blade going. And then when you stop it, everything falls and you can pulse it again. But because this is pretty full, I'm gonna take the lid off and give it a stir so that we do get some of the items at the top to help bring them to the bottom, okay? Okay, so if you're avoiding the nutritional yeast, leave it out. Leave it out completely. And there's no need to replace it either. And same goes for the bell pepper. But like I said, you can add in other vegetables. So if you're leaving out the nutritional yeast and the bell pepper, a great option would be to add in mushroom. Mushroom would give you the umami from the nutritional yeast, or the replace the umami of the nutritional yeast, and it would replace the vegetable, the moisture, and the fiber content of the bell pepper. Okay, so mushrooms would be my first option for you, Stephanie. Even beans, right? Beans in place of the cashews would work great as well. And to all of these questions about replacing things, you can make this without so many ingredients. Truly, you can. I actually did this with just sweet potato and a few spices, and I didn't have the nutritional yeast added. I didn't add the nuts, and it turned out fantastic. So as I'm doing this, just checking to see how big the pieces are. I see some, as I'm stirring this, I see some bell pepper pieces that are still a little bit large. So I'm going to process this once more. And I forgot one ingredient. Let me know in the comments if you know what ingredient I forgot before I get to it. We are adding in another piece, another item that will help with the moisture. It will help dry it out a little bit and absorb the moisture. And that is quinoa. So I've got red quinoa here, but any quinoa will work. This quinoa is just from the bulk bins, so it hasn't been rinsed. If you want to rinse it ahead of time, I'm going to measure out how much I need, actually. We're going to do... Sorry, I should highlight some of these things on my recipe. There we go. A quarter cup of quinoa. So we just measure this. And if you don't want to use quinoa, you could do oats instead. But what I was about to say was that I have not rinsed this. So someone that notices the bitterness of quinoa a lot, you might not want to use unrinsed quinoa. You could do oats in that case. Or you can rinse the quinoa ahead of time and then toast it to dry it out. I just talked about this in my private membership call on Wednesday. But the easier option, instead of rinsing it yourself and toasting it, if you're looking to make quinoa flour, is to buy pre-rinsed quinoa. And then they would have dried it out already for you, and you can add that. But personally, with such a small amount of quinoa, I don't notice any bitterness here. Okay. Yep, we haven't added the parsley yet either. That is going to go in, and I normally would have added the parsley in with the bell pepper. I like to add the bell pepper and the quinoa, or I like to add the bell pepper and the parsley last, because they have a beautiful color to them, and if you can leave them a little bit larger in size, rather than being completely blended, like this is our flour here. And actually, I'm going to process this once more. Once you open it up, you can see how it is. Quinoa, some of those bits, like chia seeds, they're so tiny that it can take a little bit to really process all of it. And if you get a few in there that are not ground up, no big deal. Okay. This is going to go in. And then our parsley here. So I've got just a half a cup of parsley, which might seem like a lot, but it's really not. And you could use cilantro instead of parsley if you like. Okay. And so that's looks like a great amount. And again, we don't need to chop it finely because it's going in the processor, but I did already blend up those the bell pepper once, so I don't want to over process it now. So I'm going to just give this a chop before adding it. Okay, All of that goes in. All right, so you guys notice how fast this is coming together. I have to check the recipe for a couple of measurements, but even so, once you know your recipes, they are so easy to make. So quick, to the point where you don't even need a recipe. You're just adding everything together, you know, because you know the template, basically, the core meal, right? So pass it to this. Oh, Gina, you made these for New Year's Eve. Awesome. So that quinoa didn't get mixed in very well because the blender is so full. So just stir that in. Oh, it smells so good already. And this is raw. It's not even cooked yet and it's smelling good. All right. Process that once more. All right. I have a question for you, totally non-related. But I'm wondering out there, who's read the book? This is one of my all-time favorite books, and I recommend it. I'm gonna be recommending it in an over email to you guys because it's so important. And then I'm gonna recommend a handbook to go with it to implement what's being talked about in the book. But have you read the book called Why We Sleep? Why We Sleep by, I think it's Matthew Walker might be the author. Fantastic book. Let me know in the comments if you've already read it. All right. And I'll put a link to that in the show notes as well. After the show, I'll put a link in there so people watching the recording can easily get that. Oh, this is perfect. And do you have, I don't have an Amazon shop page. I haven't been able to implement Amazon page because they actually kicked me off of it. I promoted a Instant Pot sale over email and they knocked me off of Amazon because that is not allowed. You cannot promote over email. So I've been kicked off. But I am going to get a platform started for that store one way or another because I have so many recommendations, not just in the kitchen, but also with that book, like I said, and other things to help our lifestyle. So what I need here is a big parchment, big sheet pan with parchment paper so I can roll these out into little pizza bites, okay? Now here, I have one, and this is actually a mesh tray, and I can't for the life of me find the exact company. I've looked it up. It doesn't have a name on it, and I can't find where I bought it from. But I highly recommend having a mesh tray like this because, especially if you don't have an air fryer, this is a great way to improve the circulation of your dishes. Okay, so I'm just going to show you what this looks like. And you can find one online by looking up a mesh or perforated sheet pan baking tray. Okay, and we have just gonna take a handful here and mush this together. So this is a very, we've been talking about moisture a lot here, but this is a very moist batter, okay? If you want it drier, you can do that. But what I like is to have this be crispy on the outside and moist in the middle, okay? So you want to kind of squeeze this batter together to help everything, you know, kind of integrate and take shape. At the same time, you don't want to squeeze it too much, otherwise it'll just end up with mush and there'll be no pretty shape to it, okay? So just take all these in your hand and process this. Now, I was saying that I've made these with sweet potato. If you want to do this with sweet potato, you could just put a partially or fully cooked sweet potato in the food processor just like this. Or what I did was actually grate the sweet potato. I grated the sweet potato and then I added all of these mixed, and then I steamed it. I steam the sweet potato once it was grated. I've heard people actually do the opposite where they steam the whole sweet potato or big halves of sweet potato and then grate it. And I've never done that, but I'm curious how it works out. So I just grated the sweet potato and then put it into a pot on the stove and cooked that grated potato, not overcooked it because you don't want to end up with a mash, but just cooked it and then mixed that grated sweet potato with the seasonings of this recipe, okay? With the red bell pepper, or the red pepper flakes, the garlic, the herbs, and if you wanted to, you could add the nutritional yeast or you could leave it out. Another option to add there would be, if you know well your world, Dylan Holmes' new company, which is fantastic, SOS-free company, offering SOS-free products, meaning no sugar, oil, or salt. It's a great option. They have a cheesy powder, and that cheese powder could go in place of the nutritional yeast. It still has nutritional yeast, but it also has some other ingredients. So if that's something you have on hand, this is a recipe that could work with that product. And speaking of that, which would be a totally different flavor, but that mushroom powder would also work well, your world's mushroom powder. Okay, so you get the idea. Everything I'm doing here, making these little bites, super simple. Just takes a little bit of that meditation time going in, or if you've got some music going in the kitchen, enjoying your time dancing here, either way, maybe talking with your co-chefs in the kitchen, or maybe your kids watching, whatever it is. You want to make all of the batter. You can freeze some of it ahead of time too. If you're going to do that though, I would partially cook it first and then pull them out, let them cool and freeze them. But these are great frozen because you can just pop them back in the oven, reheat them really easily, and it's okay. As long as you don't overcook them the first time before freezing them, you can pull them out and put them in the oven and they'll get nice and crispy. Really, really enjoyable. So I'm gonna pull out my pizza bites right now for you. Oh, so these are what they're looking like. Crispy. I turned up the heat to 425, so these would be ready for us a little bit sooner. So they're getting nice and crispy on the inside, on the outside, but I can feel when I touch them that they're a little bit soft on the inside. So you don't want to, these could go back in, and at a lower temperature, you're going to draw out more of the moisture from the middle. Okay, so if you really didn't want that moisture in the middle as much, you could do this, cook this at 375 instead of 400 like the recipe says. But all I need to do is let these cool a little bit, and then they'll be a great texture for us to add to or dip into our sauce. So I'm just gonna set these here as we prepare our sauce, okay? Now, for this sauce that's so simple to make, we have strained tomatoes here. You could use a tomato sauce, but often a tomato sauce is going to have other things added to it. Could be salt, but it could be just citric acid. And citric acid is something that is highly processed. It's in so many of our ingredients and so many of our food products, so it's not something that is essential to avoid, but if you can avoid it, by all means, please do. And strained tomatoes is a way to, for the most part, the strained tomatoes that I buy, it's only strained tomatoes. This product is fantastic. It's BioNature. BioNature with nature spelled N-A-T-U-R-A-E. And I love this company because they put all of their tomato products in glass jars. So no PPA, and you get a lid that can screw back on. Fantastic. So what we need to do is just stir together a little bit of our sauce here. And you can do this right on the stovetop. Add everything to a little saucepan on the stovetop to warm up your sauce. But I'm just gonna pour it into a little bowl here. And we're gonna do 1.5 cups. Okay. And in the description below this video, in addition to the blog post for the cauliflower pizza bites, I also have two links to other recipes. One is my pizza sauce. It's actually a pizza sauce with sun-dried tomatoes. And then another one is marinara sauce. And both of those are fabulous and would be excellent options for this. I should have even added my sugar-free ketchup. The ketchup would also be fantastic. But those would take a little bit longer. This is even quicker and easier. So if you're just, you know, this, especially if you have kids or whether it's for yourself or your kids, it's so great to be able to make this recipe really quickly. All right, so I have my strained tomatoes, and then I'm going to add in some Italian herbs. Now you could do a mixture, just like we put in the cauliflower pizza bites. We put in thyme and oregano, garlic, and red pepper flakes. That's a really great Italian mix. But if you go to your grocery store, you may actually come across some salt-free blends. And if you can get a salt-free blend, I highly recommend it, because then you have even more ease in the kitchen. And if you can't, you can always make your own SOS-free blends. But this one here is, I think it's thyme, basil, the garlic flakes, and fennel seed, ground up. And so this is, it's a delicious seasoning, but it's super easy. And the ratio of sauce to spice blend or herb blend, if you're doing this, depending on the individual, but about, start with 1 teaspoon to 1 cup. Okay, then you can go up from there if you'd like to. And I actually do want to add a little bit more here. And I do recommend heating this sauce. It's a lot more. Heating it, because it will help to integrate all the flavor together, and the warmth will just be really nice. Now in the recipe, there's one other ingredient. This is optional, but a tomato or a date paste or a date syrup is a great addition to balance out the tang. Let's see, we gotta shake this guy. To balance out the tang from the tomatoes, the acid from the tomatoes. So if you make I grew up with a delicious pizza sauce and marinara, basically any tomato sauce my mother made, there was sugar added to it. Lots of brown sugar to the marinara sauce we had every other night. So instead of sugar or brown sugar, just adding a little bit of the date paste or date syrup here is a great option, because it's so, it's already processed, so that you can just stir it in. But the even more whole food option would be to add a whole date. In that case though, you would need to put it into the blender. And if you are going to put this into the blender, then in addition to the date, I would also recommend adding a green of some sort. I like using spinach or collards or even lettuce, romaine lettuce would work, butter lettuce would work. But just a little bit of a leafy green will add in some natural sodium, and it will help, just a little bit of that bitterness will help to even out the, and a little bit of umami as well, but you don't need more umami when you got tomato sauce here. It will help to even out the tang and the acid from the tomatoes, okay? So I'm gonna pour our sauce into a smaller container here so we can dip it. And I'm gonna grab a plate. You can serve this on. Let's do this one. Okay. Stir that. We pour our sauce into our little cup here. Let me know if you have any questions in the comments. Get to that right away. I'm curious if you guys, if anyone's read How We Sleep. Haven't checked in on that yet. So you can, regarding the, Colleen, you asked if you need to flip these. You can flip them. You don't need to though. The issue with flipping them, if you guys can see this here, these little guys, if you flip them, it's going to, the idea would be to get better consistency all the way around, outside consistency of presentation wise, right? Because if you turn them upside down, like I have them, they're a lot browner on the bottom than on top. The thing is, if you flip them, you're going to end up with a little bit of browning on the top and bottom, so it's not going to be circular all the way around. The other issue is that they are a little bit soft, so if you try to flip them too early before getting the browning on the bottom, then they might kind of fall apart on you, okay? So it's up to you, but I do recommend serving these right away, letting them cool just a bit so they kind of firm up a little bit, but only 5 minutes or so, because they do cool really fast. Not even 5 minutes, just a few minutes. They cool really fast, and then you don't want them to be cold when you serve them, okay? And the other thing about cooling them, you want them to firm up, but it's also a good idea to let them cool before biting into it, because it can be really hot to bite into these, okay? So there you go. How fast, quick and easy was that? Delicious. Let me see, go up here. Let me see, switch the cameras. Actually, we'll get you a... Yum. All right, so let's try one out. Sauce. Mmm. Mm-hmm. I want to show you what it looks like. You see that on the inside? So it's very moist on the inside, but great flavor. Again, enjoy these right out of the oven so they're nice and hot for you. And let's see. Oh, Susan, I'm so glad you're going to enjoy these for a party sometime. How much dates are up to one date? It depends on the consistency of the date, or the consistency of the date. Well, that's true. Deglet and medjool dates are very different, but also the consistency of the paste or the syrup. So in general, I would say to taste, okay? To taste, starting with, if you have 1.5 cups of the sauce, like the recipe is written for, I would do just one date. And if you're using a syrup, then I would do a teaspoon would be enough, okay? But if you're serving this to kids and they are coming from a diet that is very high in sugar, like I was saying how I grew up with that, then you might actually want to add a little bit more. You might want to do a tablespoon of the syrup or 2 dates. Remember, dates are incredibly nutritious and healthy, and that's why I actually recommend doing whole dates if you have the time to put this into a blender, because they are so nutritious, right? That's not something we should be avoiding. Dates are fantastic for the nutrition and the fiber and everything, and then you get to enjoy the sweetness as well. You just want to be careful that you don't overdo it. And with kids, I would rather them have a really delicious tomato-rich sauce that had some dates in it, rather than having a store-bought tomato sauce that has sugar added to it, plus the oil, plus the salt, right? So you got to work with what you have and the taste buds of whoever you're serving, okay? What other questions? Yes, quinoa is not a grain. Great point. We use it like a grain in the culinary world, but it's actually a seed. Super nutritious. So you guys, no one had mentioned, I didn't see any comments about this, the book. I think that's a sign that you guys need to read it. Yep. So I'm so serious about this. It might seem like it's out of left field, but the top 3 books I would recommend, I'd have to think really hard about which plant-based book I'd recommend, because there's so many good ones today, but up there in the top 3 would be Why We Sleep. It is that important. So I'm going to be talking a little bit more about sleep in the next week or so. And this recipe is on the blog. If you do a search for cauliflower pizza bites, you'll find it, but I have the link in the description below the video. I'd recommend, though, and I would love for you to join our email list. And if you're interested in doing that to get the downloadable, printable recipe, then go to that link, featured recipe in the description, and I'll send it to you. And that's the best way. And then you get all of the notifications when we go live in the future. Yes, I know. I wish people were here with me too. Have a little party. Enjoy these together. So speaking of being together, I mentioned it. I was thinking about doing some live classes, in-person classes in 2021 at my parents' home, where they're actually building, they're creating a plant-based, like a mixture of a plant-based center and a plant-based bed and breakfast. So if anyone is interested in coming up to Polsbo and checking it out, you know, in the next 6 months, we'll be getting our classes going and you can stay the night. Beautiful home in the woods, a little forest, and it's such an amazing city here. It's tiny, not tiny, but a little town with mountains and water all around. We'd love to be in person with you. We're gonna be doing, like I said, it could be a bed and breakfast. People can come, but you could also do a private class with me. We can have dinner parties and be in the kitchen making all this deliciousness together. You could just do some R&R, enjoy your quiet time. You have a private studio in the back. So anyway, stay tuned for more details about that. But hope you guys definitely enjoy these cauliflower pizza bites. Again, you can do it with the sweet potato. And I love the sweet potato option so much that I'm gonna turn that into a entirely different recipe, sweet potato tots. I know people love, you know, kind of like tater tots, but with sweet potato, and that's a common thing in the, at least in California restaurants, but it's generally pretty processed, lots of salt, and all fried, deep fried with all the oil and everything. So I'm going to show you how you can do that really easily at home. But for now, this weekend, enjoy these delicious cauliflower bites. And I will see you next week for another episode of Delicious Living with Katie May for flavor, vitality, and joy. Thank you all for being here.